Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday Morning and the Old Cookbook Show. Today, we're going to do a recipe out of this old cookbook sent in by some viewers. Thank you very much for the books. And it is Mrs. Beeton's Cookery, new edition. Now, I have no clue, maybe a little bit of a clue, but no real firm evidence of what year this was published. Somewhere between 1901 and 1927. And I'm thinking probably between the end of World War I and the beginning of the Great Depression. And it's not dated. So a little bit about Mrs. Beeton while I start on the recipe. We're going to make a tomato soup, by the way. Is that Mrs. Beeton, her husband published a magazine. And so in the late 1850s, she started publishing stories in this magazine. They were cookery stories. There were stories about managing your household and recipes and all that sort of thing. And at the end of the 1850s, 1859, they started doing a serialized cookbook. And by 1861, they published an actual cookbook. And this publishing went on through the early 1860s until Mrs. Beeton dies in 1865. Her husband falls on hard financial times, ends up selling the rights to the cookbook to another publisher. The other publisher obfuscates the death of Mrs. Beeton and continues on publishing and improving and increasing this cookbook, treating Mrs. Beeton as an actual person until they finally have to give up and say, yes, she's dead. And at that point, it really becomes a brand. And so this cookbook was published over and over and over and over and brought up to date, and the recipes have been improved, and it was published in England, it was published in Australia, there were versions published here in Canada, and it's become a very important cookery book for this time period. So the instructions are to fry off some bacon or some ham, and then add to it some diced carrot and onion. So that's going to go in, and we'll continue frying that until they're all softened. And I really like this cookbook because it's plain and simple. So many cookbooks that you see are written with these giant aspirational recipes that have ingredients that you can't get or techniques that you can't possibly ever master at home, or you can't possibly ever master at home if you've only made the recipe once. This cookbook is plain, it's simple, it's straightforward. It's written for people who are decidedly middle class. It uses ingredients that are easy to obtain, and it also relies, I'm not going to say heavily, but fairly heavily on using products that are convenience products. There's recipes in here for curry where she tells you to go out and get the best curry powder or even a curry paste, a tinned curry paste. And so this is, you know, the early 1900s, and she's relying on these foods. And this recipe says that you can use fresh or canned tomatoes. There's a whole section on using tinned meats. It really is a good, straightforward recipe book that I can see using today in the 2020s because everything's available and none of the recipes in here are really going to break the bank. Although there are recipes for things that I can no longer find, like tinned lamb's tongue. I know that you can still get tinned lamb's tongue probably in New Zealand and Australia. Not available here, and I can't even find it online, anyone that will ship me a can, because I'd really like to try the recipe. Okay, the next thing in is a can of tomatoes. So I'll just stir that in. Next she calls for a bouquet-garni of parsley, thyme, and bay leaves, and I'm not going to tie that up real nice. I'm just going to put it in. I'll fish the bay leaves out before we move on to the part where we blitz this up or put it through a strainer is what she actually asks for. So now I'm supposed to cook this for about 15 minutes. So we'll just let that simmer away and come together. Now the next instruction is to add some stock and then let it simmer away on the stovetop until all the vegetables are really soft. And because you're supposed to rub this through a sieve in order to make it a nice smooth soup. I imagine this next step could take 25 or 30 minutes. Not too long, really, when you're thinking about making a soup. Now, the veg has gotten nice and soft, so I'm going to fish out the bay leaf. I'm going to leave the thyme and the parsley in there. The recipe tells me to force it through a wire sieve. So we're supposed to make the soup completely smooth. I'm really torn about that because I'm looking at this soup and I'm thinking, looks really good as a chunky soup. And I think I'd serve it just like this and it would be fantastic. But Mrs. Beeton wants smooth soup, so we're going to make it smooth. Now, you could force this through a wire mesh strainer if you have one and you want to go through that process. You could stick this in a countertop blender. I'm going to use a stick blender because I've got one and it's fairly easy. So I'm just going to blend this until it's smooth. Okay, I think this is looking pretty good. I think we are pretty smooth. It's kind of thick too, which leads me to an ingredient that we're about to put in, which is sago. It asks for a tablespoon of fine sago, and I guess that's to thicken up the soup. And if you can't find fine sago where you live, fine tapioca or minute tapioca would work just as well. So I'm going to put that in. And we finally reached the point in the recipe where she asks us to season it with salt and pepper. So this is seasoned with salt and pepper at this point to taste. We're supposed to bring this back up to a boil until the sago is translucent or firm or cooked through. And that will add that little bit of thickening. Hey, Jules.
Hey, Glen. Hey, friends. Smells good in here.
Tomato soup. Get some spoons, right, and I will dish out the soup. Now,
it looks very like a classic tomato soup recipe.
It is. I mean, it is from Mrs. Beeton's cookbook. Sometime between 1901 and 1927, I think this one was published. Who knows? I put sago in this, or tapioca.
Okay.
You could use either sago or tapioca. I know they're different things. They do the same thing in the soup, but I don't think you have to put it in. I don't think that that it changed the soup at all, having tasted it a little bit before you came in. I cheated.
Where does the smoky flavor come from?
It's the bacon.
Oh!
It's bacon.
Bacon, of course. That's, you know.
So the bacon is fried first and put into the soup. And if you were to her instruction is to put it through a fine sieve. The bacon would never get through the fine sieve.
I was going to say, why would you sieve out your bacon?
Exactly.
I see it now that I've, you know, second scoop in, I can see a little tiny piece.
I just took an immersion blender and blended it smooth. And I think for 2021, that's probably the way to go. Leave the bacon in there.
Ooh. You don't think the tapioca or the sago was for thickening it at all?
I think the sago from the recipe is there to thicken it a little bit. But again, because I used an immersion blender, or if you used a blender on the countertop, it's going to be naturally thicker than if you forced it through a sieve. So I don't know that it's completely necessary.
That's a very lovely soup.
The flavor is fantastic. Yeah. I really like the flavor.
Some toast and I'm good to go. Mm-hmm.
So Mrs. Beeton's cookbook. I think there's some amazing recipes in there that are completely transferable to today. They're simple, straightforward, easy ingredients, and not all that expensive to make.
There you go, Mrs. Beeton.
Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.